Welcome and thank you for being with us tonight. My name is Kristen Lilliman and I'm an engagement specialist with Dillon Consulting. We have been working with the city to coordinate and facilitate the engagement for the Municipal Comprehensive Review, or as you may know it, our Plan Toronto. And many of you may have attended or participated in meetings in the past, in the fall for the official plan, as well as recent meetings we had on the environment and climate change policies in April. So this is the first meeting tonight for Etobicoke York, and it's in a series of meetings to present the draft policies, vision, directions, and principles that will all go to Planning and Housing Committee on July 5th. So thank you for being with us tonight, and we'll go to the next slide. I'll begin tonight with a land acknowledgement. The City of Toronto acknowledges that we are on the traditional territory of many nations, including the Mississaugas of the Credit, the Anishinaabe, the Chippewa, the Haudenosaunee, and the Wendat peoples, and is now home to many diverse First Nations, Inuit, and Métis peoples. The city also acknowledges that Toronto is covered by Treaty 13 signed with the Mississaugas of the Credit and the Williams Treaties signed with multiple Mississaugas and Chippewa bands. Acknowledging the land that we're on, which is tradition in most meetings now, it's only a small piece of recognizing the contributions and the history of Indigenous peoples and our progress as well towards reconciliation. It's important to also recognize that the Indigenous connection to the land that we now call Toronto and Lake Ontario dates back at least 10,000 years. A key part of our Plan Toronto is and has been the integration of Indigenous perspectives and voices and understandings as part of this process. The team has also integrated the great work on the Reconciliation Action Plan into this renewed official plan, which you'll hear more about later in the presentation. Okay, next slide. The agenda for today. So it includes a backgrounder and refresher on the official plan, especially in case you didn't attend a previous meeting. We'll provide an overview, well, city staff will provide an overview of the major transit station areas, an update on the employment policies and employment area conversions, an overview of the Indigenous planning perspectives, and the draft official plan vision statement and directions. And as you can see from the agenda, there is time for questions and discussion between each section. We will then share the next steps and how you can continue to be engaged in the project, and we'll hope to wrap up the meeting by 8 p.m. tonight. Next slide. So just a few introductions of who is present in the meeting today. We're joined today by those at the city who are leading the official plan, including Jeff Cantos, who will introduce the city team now.
Hi everyone, and thanks, Kristen. As Kristen mentioned, my name is Jeff Cantos. I'm the manager of the city's official plan team, and I'm joined by a number of city staff who are here tonight who will act as resources for answering your questions during the Q&A period or in the chat. So feel free to use the chat function. We've got staff from my team, the official plan team, staff working on the MTSAs, staff working on expanding housing options in neighborhoods, and economic and development and culture staff also. So a broad array of resources that can help help you navigate through the chat and also during the Q&A period. Back over to you, Kristen.
Hey, thanks, Jeff. So I also want to reintroduce a few people we also have here from Dillon Consulting. We have Nicole Bugley and Ish Chowdhury, who will be helping manage the meeting from behind the scenes, including taking minutes. And they also may appear in the chat to answer questions. So I'd also love to welcome participants who we have on the call tonight to introduce themselves in the chat. We'd love to know who is joining us today and also get to know each other like you might at an in-person meeting. So next slide, please. So just a bit of housekeeping before we get started. Just a reminder to stay muted when you're not talking. If you do have a question or comment, which we do expect, please use the raise hand function or type your question into the chat box. So as Jeff mentioned, we are encouraging use of the chat box and it will be monitored by staff. And questions may be responded to live there. There are also dedicated discussion points, as I mentioned, throughout the meeting. And we are encouraging you to ask questions and raise comments, but please introduce yourself before asking your question so we know who we're hearing from. As you may have noticed, this meeting is being recorded today. We will only post the presentation component to the website. The comments and discussion that occurs during this meeting will just be used for note-taking purposes only. So a little note on my role as meeting facilitator tonight and for the other meetings in this series. My job is to manage the discussion and make sure everyone gets a chance to be heard. I want to ensure that everyone is able to participate and have their questions answered. And there may be a number of people joining tonight, and we want you to think about and ask the question that you most want to have answered, because there may be a number of hands raised and questions in the chat box. We strongly suggest one question per person, and I will hold you accountable to that. If you don't get your question answered live, there will be a Q&A in our engagement records. Next question, please. Next slide, sorry. Okay, some participant guidelines for you. We do, again, welcome your questions and discussion. There are no bad questions. Chances, if you're thinking about it, someone else is as well on the call. We want to hear from everyone. Again, that's my job as facilitator to make sure we do. And we do believe that everyone has wisdom and experience to share. We also recognize there may be differences in opinion and perspectives. And that's when we have to be respectful and listen to each other, because everyone deserves to be heard. The city is here today to listen to your feedback, thoughts, and perspectives. That is one of the intentions of this meeting, so please don't be shy in sharing. Next slide. So as mentioned, the chat function will be available throughout the meeting. We are encouraging the use of it to share ideas, get to know each other, ask your questions. But just a reminder to be respectful. We want to keep it active, but if there are any disrespectful or abusive comments, we will have to close the chat. Next slide, please. So why are we here tonight on this beautiful spring evening? City staff are going to provide an overview for you on the draft employment policies, the major transit station area delineations, and the draft official plan vision and directions. Again, we want to hear your feedback, so we will open it up at key points for questions and dialogue. We'll also share the next steps with you and how you can continue to be engaged. Next slide. So this slide provides a quick snapshot of the project process. So the project initially launched back in May last year, and we've gone through parts one, the vision and priorities, and part two, asking big questions and setting policy directions. During that time, the city and our Dillon engagement team have been doing a lot of listening through public meetings, youth engagement, online engagement and surveys, meetings with Indigenous rights holders and organizations, and through a community leaders circle. Now we're at the point where the city has created draft policies, and we're here in part three, and we are continuing to meet with people and organizations to discuss our Plan Toronto and the draft policies. So far in this part three, we have held meetings, as I mentioned, on the draft environment and climate change policies that went to the May 31st Planning and Housing Committee and then City Council on June 15th. We are now hosting, again, a series of meetings, of public meetings on the other draft official plan policies, which is all leading to a report to the Planning and Housing Committee on July 5th. We will also be sharing some other upcoming meeting dates with you at the end of this presentation. Next slide. So this is just a bit of an engagement snapshot. In part one and part two, and so far in part three, we've held over 60 meetings and met with over 2,000 people with various internal and external stakeholders, organizations, companies, residents. This work has included a focus on reaching underrepresented, equity-deserving populations and groups that work with them, like Indigenous rights holders and organizations, youth through schools and school boards, seniors through the Seniors Roundtable, and focus conversations. This work has also included some focus conversations, including around accessibility and specific geographies like Scarborough. We've also had an online component of the engagement, and the Our Plan website and our story maps, which is our online resource to explore information and maps related to Our Plan Toronto, they have received over 10,000 visits. Next slide. So our team has organized all of the input we've received to date from part one, part two, and the beginning of part three into key themes the cross-cutting themes, which you see on the left of your screen, these are themes that emerged in every meeting across different organizations and groups, in different communities, and with Indigenous organizations. And what emerged, you can see, is there are four things. One was having a key focus on equity, inclusion, and relationship building. And that was including addressing inequities across the city, a call to be more inclusive and reflect the diversity in the city, require universal and accessible design. And then we have community-led solutions. And that was a call to work collaboratively with communities, especially when it comes to big change in neighborhoods, like big development. Learning from the past and implementation, and most particularly around understanding a history of communities and some of the issues that are present in those communities. Aligning priorities and conversations, and that's getting everyone on the same page, and that also included leadership alignment. So the other themes in the darker green on the right-hand side are themes that were the most frequently raised issues and topics. And that included housing affordability and the scale of intensification. And that involved the need to balance development with other infrastructure like transit and green space. Environment and climate change, that was the meetings we had, the specific focus of the meetings we held in April. And a lot of the issues that emerged and topics that emerged were a plan to get to net zero, promote active transit, protecting green space and trees. Jobs was a theme that was common and that was particularly heightened through COVID. Safety and complete communities, where every neighborhood needed a complete communities approach and have a universal design so people don't age out of them. So those were the key themes, the kind of highlights of the key themes that have emerged to date. And we look forward to hearing what comes out of the meetings this round. So we'll go to the next slide. So we have an engagement moment and we'll go to the next slide. We are gonna be having some polling questions throughout the meeting tonight. So I'll ask you to go visit menti.com or you can scan the QR code that is up on the screen. Once you get to the site, you will be asked on the top of the site, you'll be asked to enter a code and you'll enter the code that's on the screen there. So if someone's also put in the chat, thank you, Ish, there's the link to the Mentimeter. And so once you get there, you'll enter code 99821574. And I will also do the same. So we have a few questions to get us started and find out a little bit about who is here tonight and a little bit on how you've participated in the past in this project. So Nicole is going to put up the Mentimeter polling so we can see the live results. So far we can see the majority of participants coming, calling in from Etobicoke, which is great because that's what this meeting was specifically for, Etobicoke, New York. And we see a scattering of others participating from across the city. We'll give people some time to log on. Again, you can go to menti.com and use that code that's on the screen now. We're going to be using this throughout the night. So once we're going to have a few questions now, but we'll come back to this a few times. So leave it open on you can either use a phone or your desktop top computer and just leave it open through the night so you can respond to some of the other questions that we ask. We're going to be asking kind of to get to know you, but also to see, get feedback from you on various topics, as well as test that you're paying attention at some point. Okay, so I see, yeah, the majority of people calling in from Etobicoke. Maybe we can, Nicole, if you don't see other people joining, maybe we can go to the next question. So we have our next question here is, have you participated in other or planned Toronto engagement activities? And so far we have the majority with yes, but many who haven't. So thank you for joining us for the first time tonight. And for those who have participated before, thanks for coming back. Okay, so this is for those who did participate in the past, how did you previously participate? And there's been a number of engagement activities, as I outlined earlier. There was virtual meetings like this one. There's other kind of meetings like stakeholder meetings. There's online survey, there's community leader circle, website and social media, and also the story map that we mentioned earlier. Okay, so we have a few people who've participated in some virtual meetings or the online survey, and then a couple people who have participated online and the website and the story map. Okay, so the next question. This is just to understand your familiarity with the official plan. So how familiar are you with the Toronto official plan? It seems like many of you do have some familiarity and many with very and extremely familiar. So we do have a knowledgeable bunch here. So I think we have one more question before we move on with the presentation. And it's to dive in. So for those of you who do use the Toronto official plan, we're wondering how you use that. So is it as a resident, as a member of a group, for work, which I'm seeing many people are choosing. If you're a student, so you're using it that way, or if there's another reason why you're using it. Okay, so many people as a member of a group or organization and for work. And a few as a resident. Okay, well, thanks everyone for participating. Again, keep this open on your desktop or your cell phone because we will have a number of other questions throughout the meeting. But I will now hand it over to Jeff to provide an overview and the background on the official plan. And I'll have Nicole bring back up the presentation.
Thanks, Kristen. And thanks everyone for participating in the Menti polls. Kind of, it gives me a good sense of how deep I should go into the official plan with everyone. So, you know, about, I think it was half of you that have been to one of our Plan Toronto meetings and the other half that haven't, and then about half and half in terms of familiarity with the official plan. So we'll take you through a quick or moderate level official plan refresher. Next slide, please. So in this slide, it shows that the City of Toronto is part of a bigger region, and we're nestled in what's called the Greater Golden Horseshoe Area, which has a population of 10.2 million. And, you know, it's the Greater Golden Horseshoe Area spans across the GTA from Niagara region to Peterborough. And there we are, the City of Toronto, with a population of about 2.8 million, again, nestled into a region, which is nestled into, obviously, the province of Ontario at 4.7 million people. The next slide, please. And in keeping with this thread of nestling, the planning, the land use planning system, the official plan is also nestled into a number of different layers of planning policy. So at the very, very top in Ontario, the overarching planning direction comes from the province and is filtered through into local planning decisions. And that's the nestling that you see in this image. So at the top rung is the top tier of planning policy and legislation. So this deals with matters of provincial interest, like the Planning Act, the provincial policy statement, and then it goes into regional planning matters like the Greater Golden, the growth plan for the Greater Golden Horseshoe, or some of you might know the Greenbelt plan as well. And nestled there in the middle is the citywide vision, which is our official plan that we are currently reviewing. And within our official plan, there are secondary plans, local area studies, things that we call precinct plans, but these are just a larger neighborhood plans. And when we go from the citywide vision, we move into the precision, which is the area specific standards called our zoning bylaw. And then you get down to the very, very, very site specific precision, which is a zoning bylaw for one site. Next slide, please. So we're here talking about the official plan. So the OP, or the official plan, is a city planning document that is adopted by city council and acts as our roadmap for land use matters. It sets out our long-term vision, shared values, land use policies that help us at the city guide decision-making on land development, economic growth, the environment, and more. And it also helps us determine and distinguish where different types of development should and should not go. Next slide, please. The city's official plan is broken up into different chapters. The chapters with citywide policies are these different gears on this slide. And the biggest gear at the bottom in the center are the land use designations. And the land use designation map at the bottom right is where we have different policies for different areas of the city. And on the next slide, if you were to break the city down into 100 blocks, you would see that about 35% of the city is designated neighborhoods. There in the yellow, 19% at the top of the 100 city blocks are roads to which we don't have a land use designation. And the land use designations that are targeted and planned for growth are the mixed use areas, about 5%. And for employment growth, the purple, about 13% of our city is designated either core employment areas or general employment areas. Okay, sorry, so before we move on, for those who this is your first meeting, what this process is a provincially required review process of our official plan. The province requires all municipalities within the Greater Golden Horseshoe area to take a look at their official plans to make sure that we conform to provincial plans set out by the Ministry of Municipal Affairs and Housing. So we here at the City of Toronto, along with our counterparts in the 905, are all looking at our official plans. We're doing the review, we're doing the engagement, we're doing the due diligence or the technical work, and the multiple reports that we do to city staff, to city council. And we will be bringing forward a report with some amendments to the official plan for city council's consideration. And then we bring it back up to the Minister of Municipal Affairs and Housing for their approval. The province in the growth plan for the Greater Golden Horseshoe sets out population and job targets or forecasts for us to make sure that we have a plan that accommodates that growth. So there's a minimum of 700,000 people and 450,000 jobs are the forecasts that the province sets out for the City of Toronto that we have to, again, demonstrate to the province that we have a plan to accommodate. So that's part of this process. And I'm going to pass it back over to Kristen.
Okay, thanks, Jeff. So we're going to another poll. So hopefully you have your Mentimeter still open. If you don't, again, it's menti.com. And you'll see the number coming up shortly, but it's 9982-1574. So this is a bit of a testing that you're paying attention to Jeff's presentation there. So what is the official plan? Is it a roadmap for planning in Toronto? Does it set the long-term vision for the city? Does it direct where development should go or provide the building blocks for complete communities or all of the above? Okay, so most of you got this correct. It is all of the above, but many of you may have clicked all of them because you could check more than one. So some of you may have also been correct if you clicked all four. Okay, thank you, everyone.
Great, thanks, Kristen. My mic's on, I'm assuming.
Yes, you're good.
And so, yeah, thanks everyone for taking time out of your evening to join us here tonight. I'm going to walk you through some of the work we've been doing on identifying and delineating, basically drawing the boundaries around major transit station areas and protected major transit station areas. So this is a major component of the intensification strategy of the Municipal Comprehensive Review. As Jeff mentioned earlier, the province's growth plan is kind of the overarching plan that directs what happens in this plan. And it requires us to delineate all transit stations that are either subway stations or are identified in the growth plan as a priority transit corridor. Next slide. So if you look across Toronto, there's approximately 140 major transit station areas, and these are all the subway, LRT, and GO stations across the city. The area itself includes any property or lot generally within a 10-minute walk of the transit station. So that ends up being about 500 to 800 meters. Essentially, if you can walk out your front door, leave your school or office or whatever, and get to the transit station in a 10-minute walk, that area would probably be part of the NTSA. So the growth plan requires a municipality to ensure that the land use policy within that 10-minute walking distance that it ensures higher levels of density, which is measured in people and jobs. So for subway stations, we need to demonstrate that we have a planned minimum density of 200 people and jobs per hectare. For light rail transit or LRT, that's 160. And then for regional transit, or in our case, GO, it's 150 people and jobs per hectare. And so I should emphasize that those are the minimums that the growth plan requires. As you'll see, if you look through some of these proposed MTSAs and the draft MTSAs, we have higher targets than those minimums. So the intent of this all is really to make sure that we're planning for higher levels of density in the areas that are closest to transit, making sure that we're making good use of transit infrastructure that's in place and trying to encourage people to use those forms of transportation. Next slide. So as I described earlier, each one of these stations needs to be delineated based on, on the local conditions, on constraints in the area, on the particular landscape around a station. So this map shows the stations we brought draft delineations to Planning and Housing Committee for, and it's sitting at around 140 individual stations right now. Just a note on the sort of the light gray box in Scarborough, the province has advised us actually that Shepherd East LRT doesn't need to be delineated through this process. So it's no longer identified as a priority project, the Shepherd East LRT. So in the future, there's the potential for those to be called MTSAs, but at this point, they aren't being brought forward as MTSAs. So you can skip. Okay, so now a little more detail on the protected major transit station areas. So before I get into that, I'll just introduce what inclusionary zoning is. So inclusionary zoning is the city's ability to require a percentage of affordable housing in developments of a certain size. The goals of this are to increase the supply of affordable housing, encourage market housing development by supporting a more diverse range of housing supply, and to really create a more inclusive, complete, and equitable community. So there's certain requirements in these areas for affordable housing. In November 2021, Council approved a new inclusionary zoning bylaw that was supported by a market area analysis, which looked at land value across the city. So if you look at the three colors of blue, that are on this map, those indicate the levels of land value and where the market could support, you know, different levels of affordable housing requirements. So moving back to the idea of the protected major transit station areas, PMTSA is the only place where you can apply inclusionary zoning. So these are just a subset of the 140 across the city. If you squint and look really close at this map, you can see that the yellow dots are all the stations where we've identified potential PMTSAs. And these are all the areas where there's an overlap between one of those three market areas and MTSA. So once, you know, these are approved by the province, you know, they go through the process and they're approved as PMTSAs, this unlocks the city's ability to apply inclusionary zoning in these areas. And next slide. So on this slide and the next one, I'm just going to describe a little bit of our process for defining and then refining these MTSAs. We're approaching it with a two-step growth management strategy. So step one, it's, you know, where we are today. This is our starting point. And, you know, what we, our job today really is to demonstrate that we can achieve what is required by the province. So those minimums, and to demonstrate conformity with the growth plan. So, you know, this establishes minimum densities for all of these, for all of these areas. It's, I guess, again, worth reiterating that, you know, these are minimums. So down the line, you know, in step two, we might look at increasing the density to allow for, you know, more housing, more affordable housing in certain areas. But, you know, for the most part, we're demonstrating now that the existing planning framework that Toronto has, you know, more than 90% of the MTSAs already meet or exceed the province's requirements. So for step two, as we move into the future, minimum targets, you know, based on local area studies, maybe may change, maybe increase depending on local conditions. But again, that requires, you know, appropriate studies for those areas to understand capacity needs and, you know, all those built form, urban design, traffic, environmental considerations for a particular area. And you can skip to the next one. Okay, so just to recap our process today. So far, we've brought over 130 draft protected major strands PMTSAs and MTSAs before Planning and Housing Committee for consultation. And so these are what you're seeing today. We've also brought forward 18 PMTSAs, and those have been adopted by Council, and they're currently awaiting approval by the Minister or the province. 16 of those are downtown, and two of those are at Keele and Finch. Beyond the stations that we brought to committee and council, we've identified six of those stations where the existing planning framework doesn't allow us to meet the minimums. And so those require additional study to understand, you know, what changes need to be made to the planning framework to meet those minimums. And those will be advancing later in 2023. And so we're targeting right now to bring all of these forward for consideration by Planning and Housing on July 5th. And so if you skip to the next slide, I'll just show you a little bit of how to use the interactive tool for engagement that's on the official plan website. It'll look slightly different than what you see here. So you may need to scroll down on the page to find the link. And I can also drop the link in the chat later. Oh, and Ish has already done so. So if you click on that link, you can follow along with this or look at it later at your own leisure. Next slide. So when you land on that page, there's a few pages of information, essentially what I've just told you. So if you are a reading type of person, you can scroll through that and have a look at what's there and get some of that background information that's there. Next slide. So after you scroll, you'll arrive at the bottom of that page and you'll see an interactive map tool. And so what you can do on that tool is just on the left-hand side there, you can type in, you know, the transit station near where you live or wherever you're interested in looking at. And then you'll see a list. And then once you click on one of those items in the list, one of those stations, It'll highlight the station and the station area, and then give you a bunch of information about that station on the right-hand side. Next slide. So on the top right, you'll see some stats about the station area, including the estimated population based on 2016 census data, as well as employment. You can see the overall area in hectares, as well as the planned density. So that includes stuff coming down the development pipeline and our proposed minimum target. And even as you can see here, at a subway station, our required minimum by the growth plan is 200, but in this case, at Bay, it's 900. Next slide. And again, just a little more on that point. When you look at Bay, you can see that, in the first column in 2016, the estimated density was about 487 people and jobs per hectare. The required minimum by the province is 200. Over to the third column, the planned density is 936, which is nearly four times the provincial minimum. And then, sometimes the as-of-right permissions that we have in place for a station can give you more than that. So right now, the as-of-right permissions allow for about 900 people and jobs per hectare. Next slide. There's also, when you're looking at the map, if you click on the kind of stack of squares up in the top corner of the map, you can actually turn on and off different layers. So if you want to look at, what the zoning bylaw says about a site, what the minimum density is in a particular area, things like that, you can actually turn those layers on and off while you're looking at the map. Next slide. There's also additional details. If you click on the details tab underneath the graphs, you'll be able to see a table that has a lot of extra information about each station. So that includes official plan amendments for the station and supporting documents, so like the downtown secondary plan or Etobicoke for the for Bay in this example. Next slide. Okay, so last of all, not employment policies, but if you scroll down to the bottom below that map, there's actually a place for you to add your own comments. And so you can add comments on a particular station. Just make sure at the top that you select the station that you want to provide comments on in particular, and it'll be at the top of the form. We don't actually have an image here, but there's a drop-down list. And so as you're inputting your comments, your thoughts on a particular MTSA, just make sure you're responding to a particular one so that we know when we're looking at them again and reviewing comments that we have the right station. And I think that's all from me.
Okay, thank you, Dan. We are going to go to an engagement moment. We do have another polling question or a couple polling questions, and then we'll go to the Q&A on the MTSA piece. And I do see a couple questions in the chat. So we can get to those after we go to the polling. So again, you can bring up menti.com, and we do have a few questions for you, which you already might see if you already have it open. So the first thing we wanted to know is if you live or work near one of the identified MTSAs, and you also, there's a very real possibility that you're not sure, and that's okay too. That tool that Dan outlined will can help you there. I know I checked out the station where I live and wanted to know all the details. So we have a number of people who live near an MTSA, and some who work near one, and others who don't or are not sure.
As we wait, Kristen, I can just to add, kudos to your team, the Dylan team, for helping us create the dashboard, the MTSA interactive tool, which, like you said, has had thousands of hits. It's really informative, and it's a good repository for a lot of information. So thank you to the Dylan team.
Thanks, Jeff. It's certainly fun to poke around on there. At least fun for me. I don't know what that says, but Okay, so we have a number of people who live near one. We'll go to the next question. So this is a question that, that MPSA story map tool that we've had thousands of visits on. We're curious if you have visited it before. So yes, no, and a few of you, yes, I will after this meeting. Great. A number of you, we're going to see our hits go up. And I'm hoping those people who said no will switch to the other option. I will after this meeting. And again, Ish put the link in if you do want to visit after this meeting, so you can see that in the chat or from the Our Plan website as well. So it's toronto.ca/ourplan. Okay, so we'll go to the next question, I think. I think we have one more on the MTSAs. So this is a question about those minimum density targets and people targets and job targets that Dan outlined. Should they be increased? So many people saying yes here, and a couple no, and a couple not so sure. This was also something that came up quite a bit in our environment and climate change meeting. So we were interested to hear from the people who came to these meetings as well, your thoughts on this. Okay, so the majority saying yes, with a few no and a couple I don't know. Okay, so I believe that is it for the MTSA mentee questions, but we do have a couple more throughout the presentation, so please keep that open still. Employment policies and employment area conversions, and I'll hand it back to Jeff.
Thanks, Kristen. Can you hear me okay? Yeah, okay, so we're gonna pivot to a different policy topic on employment policies and employment area conversions. Next slide, please. So employment areas serve the public interest. And what does this mean? Our employment areas, and if you can remember the box of 100, the 100 box city, I mentioned the purple lands, the lands designated as core employment areas and general employment areas. Account for 13% of the city's land mass. And these lands accommodate low barrier entry jobs. And what are these? These are the jobs these are the jobs for people who face challenges having the professional certifications recognized here in Canada, for newcomers to Canada, individuals where English is not their first language. And the jobs found in the employment areas provide a living wage, employment opportunities in local communities, especially near to transit. And from a business perspective, these purple lands, these employment areas, provide what we call land use certainty for operating businesses who provide essential goods and services for all of us. And so the city is using a equity lens when we look at our employment areas. And again, I'm joined with colleagues here from Economic and Development who are helping us with this part of our official plan review. Next slide, please. So going back to the theme of the nestling of the policies. So on the left, the province has this map called in the growth plan that identifies provincially significant employment zones. So in Etobicoke, there's some in Rexdale, some in South Etobicoke, and a little bit up north by Steeles. And so these provincially significant employment zones are identified by the growth plan, but we here at the city, we designate them as, we designate all of our employment areas, either core employment areas or general employment areas. So the map in the middle is an excerpt from the official plan. And these purple lands, these employment areas, again, they're 13% of all the lands in the city. They're about 8,100 hectares of the city. They accommodate 25% of all the jobs within the city, so about 400,000 jobs, and 92% of all manufacturing and industrial and warehousing jobs within the city are found here within our employment areas. Again, 13% of the city's landmass. And in the next slide, as part of the employment review process, we hired a consultant named Hemson, and they came up with a they came up with recommendations to the city after doing a years-long analysis of our employment areas and the trends and the job numbers and the output numbers. And there's a list of, I believe there's 20 recommendations, and we can put the link to their study in the chat. But some, I'm just going to, some of the recommendations that they provided to us were that we should, the city should be preserving lands, these employment lands, near major good movement facilities and corridors. Recommended to us another one, maintaining our conversion request criteria for employment conversions, which I'll talk about in 1 second. And we should advocate for additional provincially significant employment zones across the city. So not all the provincially identified significant employment zones are our employment areas in the official plan. Again, we can put the link to their study in the chat. Next slide, please. This slide talks about some of the other employment study findings that Hemson posed to us at the city. So again, they echoed the equity lens for our employment areas, that these lands, they help us achieve the city's equity goals, particularly in the given their strategic location. And many of our employment areas are near to what we call the neighborhood improvement areas. And again, like I mentioned, the good access to transit. Over the course of the pandemic, what we found was some of the, during, you know, the height of the pandemic and the lockdowns, what we found was the busiest transit routes were the buses in the north of the city, connecting where people live to where they worked in our employment areas, given the essential nature of their work producing the stuff that, you know, we consume. In terms of office, our consultants, you know, their recommendation to us was, it was just too early for us to change our office policies in our official plan, given that any permanent effects that may manifest in office working practices, given the return to work, may change things. So at this moment in time, with, you know, some returning to office, some doing hybrid, that they recommended to us as a city that we should just do more monitoring before we actually do any course corrections to our policy. And it's just an interesting tidbit that they brought forward to us was the continued investment within our employment areas. So some pretty staggering statistics that the value of industrial building permits within our employment areas averaged about $48 million annually per year since the year 2000. So that's 48. So when someone applies for a building permit, the more complex that application is, the higher the cost of that building permit. And so $48 million is one metric that the $48 million building permit is kind of one metric that we used. Additions and renovations were occurring in our employment areas. And those averaged value about $39 million per year, again, since 2000. And structural and other permits averaged just under about $26 million per year. So there is private investment happening within our employment areas, which to us demonstrate a level of confidence in the city's employment areas that they can be invested in, again, for the long term, given these pretty high numbers. Next slide, please. So e-commerce, one new policy that we are recommending to council that we're consulting on right now is a new, well, it's not that new, but it's new for the official plan. We currently don't have a policy supporting e-commerce, and we know that e-commerce requires centrally situated sites to give you know, access to highways and major roads, given the last mile function that these fulfillment centers play. The picture on the right is a new Amazon fulfillment center that's happening in Northeast Scarborough on our employment areas. And there are a number of these buildings, not as big as this one, that we require as people living in the city so that we can get our overnight deliveries brought to our door. So the new policy we're proposing encourages multi-level industrial development, such as these fulfillment centers, so that we can help accommodate the last mile delivery centers, as well as these types in Scarborough, the larger distribution centers. The next slide, please. What we're also looking into is what we call land use incompatibility. So another requirement that the province places upon municipalities is for us to prohibit residential uses within our employment areas. So we, as like other municipalities, have to conform to this requirement. So what we are doing as a city staff are looking at certain areas in the city where you have an employment area, but there is what we call site and area specific policies, basically an exception to the rule that might allow residential uses. So we're looking at about 13 or 12, I think there's 13 of them across the city where this kind of policy difference happens, that it's employment area, but there might be a residential permission on it. And given the requirement for us to prohibit, we're doing a deep dive on these 12 areas to see whether or not they should remain employment and we prohibit the residential, or we might have to convert them to allow the residential uses. And so this one, we are still doing our homework, and we will be reporting on this component early in 2023. Next slide, please. Another big component of our work program are what are called employment area conversions. And a conversion of an employment area is the introduction of a non-permitted use into the employment areas, such as residential. Again, from the province, they tell us to prohibit residential, but the opportunity for a landowner to request a conversion, i.e. to, or for example, to introduce residential uses, is through this municipal comprehensive review process. So we here at the city, we received about 140 of them across the city, and they require very careful consideration for each request. So we, members of my team, members of the economic development team, members of the community planning staff as well in the Etobicoke district, are looking at each and every single one of them very closely, and we're applying what I'm just calling tests set out in the provincial policies and the city policies. And so, yeah, in Etobicoke, there are some in Rexdale, there are some in South Etobicoke, pretty scattered, a lot in the Junction area as well. In the next slide, I can talk to you about the process for these conversion requests. Again, we will be posting this presentation, the slide deck and the video on our website as soon as we get the closed captioning. So similar to the MTSA boundary delineations, we've also reported on what are called preliminary assessments, about 120 of them, to Planning and Housing Committee, basically just outlining the context, the area for each conversion request. We've been doing broad engagement. We've been doing meetings with the proponents themselves, area businesses, stakeholders. We did a round of sector specific engagement with like the food and beverage sector, with the manufacturing sector, just to get as much input as possible. And members of my team, as I mentioned, are doing a very deep dive in the technical review, a citywide analysis. The province requires municipalities to conduct what's called a land needs assessment. So the results of the city's land needs assessment will also be at the July 5th Planning and Housing Committee. And on the ground, folks on my team are doing a very detailed site and area specific due diligence, basically the careful consideration that I talked about for each conversion request. So right now, members of my team are writing what are called final assessments for the July 5th Planning and Housing Committee. We've sent out notice the clerk, the city clerk, has sent out notice that we will be providing final assessments, which are our recommendations to city council for adoption on some of our conversion requests. Not all. We are taking a phased approach, and we will be bringing the remaining conversion request final assessments. Again, those are our recommendations to council in January. And the Planning and Housing Committee, the notice speaks to being able to depute in person. So that is an option. So on the right is basically the critical path that we are taking for the employment area conversions. Next slide, please. Oh, okay. Over to you, Kristen.
Okay, thanks, Jeff. So we're gonna go to another poll. So if you do have your Mentimeter open, you can go to the next question for you on employment areas. So this is kind of, again, a question testing that you are listening to the presentation. So the question is, protecting employment areas will help with the following. And so you can select all that apply. So there's jobs for newcomers, helping provide a living wage jobs, providing space for businesses, and Toronto's overall economic competitiveness. So you can select all that apply. I'm seeing most people are probably choosing them all. Which, and then a few people, I guess a few more people with the jobs for newcomers and helping provide living wage jobs. But so the answer from Jeff's presentation would be all four of these items. So it's protecting these employment areas will help with all four of these answers. So thanks everyone for participating. The next portion of the meeting. So I'll ask Jeff again to lead this portion of the presentation for the Indigenous planning perspectives.
Great. Thanks, Kristen. So this is a new section of the official plan that we are looking at changes for. And, you know, we are, when embarking upon the Our Plan Toronto process, again, we started this in April 2021, just before we all got sent home. And it provided us the opportunity to reach out to many First Nations that are not part of not within Toronto. So it was a benefit in from this perspective. So if you go to the next slide, please. So the City of Toronto Council in April of this year, so last month, adopted the Reconciliation Action Plan, and that's the 2022 to 2032. And there, I think there are 28 recommendations within the Reconciliation Action Plan that council unanimously adopted. And, you know, as part of decolonizing our structures and processes and ways of working, we think that the official plan should acknowledge the First Nations, Inuit, and Métis people and their worldviews. And in doing so, our Plan Toronto is looking at changes to the official plan that can help acknowledge this relationship. And then the next slide, I won't read these out, but these are the treaty rights holders, the First Nations advisory committees, and different organizations that we met with, reached out to through virtual meetings, through surveys, telephone calls, to basically to listen and learn about you know, Indigenous worldviews and different ways of knowing and seeing the land. On the next slide, it's kind of the process that we undertook. So back in June of last year, we went to the city's Aboriginal Affairs and Advisory Committee, known as AAAC, and we asked our Aboriginal Affairs Advisory Committee, how should we consult with First Nations and Indigenous communities across the city? And we took their advice, and we, you know, for about a year, or less than a year, we, you know, what I'm calling just listening, learning, and sharing. We continually met with members of the First Nations, with organizations, to talk about, you know, the priorities, the challenges, and other planning use, land use planning matters. And the last couple of months, we've been, you know, reflecting, drafting, and more reflecting of, you know, what we can do for the within the official plan. And so the slide says May, AAAC again, the Aboriginal Affairs Advisory Committee. We were at committee, but we got deferred. So we'll be going back in June to the AAAC with what I'm about to present to you just now. And over the course of, you know, post-July, we will continue engaging with Indigenous communities, rights holders, and organizations across the city. So here's what we were going to present to our AAAC, but truncated manner. So, so the draft Indigenous planning perspectives that we brought forward, I think it was in April of this year, to Planning and Housing Committee, talked about the official plan's role in working with Indigenous reconciliation objectives. So the first being that the official plan should recognize the importance and purpose of land acknowledgement. So we start at the city almost every public meeting or gathering with a land acknowledgement. And we think that the official plan should explain the importance and purpose of these land acknowledgements so that they don't become you know, like a pledge of allegiance, that there is meaning behind the reflection of why we do this, why we do these land acknowledgements. The official plan, again, at the beginning, right at chapter one, should seek to amplify Indigenous voices in planning processes, help, you know, members of the public, our own city staff, city councillors, help deepen the understanding of contemporary urban Indigenous realities and experiences. And the straight out of the Reconciliation Action Plan, we believe that the official plan should continue to identify opportunities for Indigenous placemaking and placekeeping initiatives in new development. So that's a recommendation right out of the Reconciliation Action Plan that speaks to new development. And then explicitly adding some text in the official plan explaining and describing the Reconciliation Action Plan. And again, it's about capacity building. It's about deepening our collective understanding of Indigenous planning perspectives. And on the next slide, as I mentioned, the Reconciliation Action Plan speaks about Indigenous placemaking and placekeeping. And what these are and what this means is that what placemaking and placekeeping is our outcomes of initiatives that are varied. You know, it can manifest its way in very different outcomes and are critical for the health and well-being of Indigenous peoples. Placemaking and placekeeping initiatives and outcomes help to strengthen connections with lands and waters for Indigenous communities. And for us as settlers and immigrants, it helps a lot of cultural competency and capacity for land-based Indigenous engagement. And the next slide, our next steps, as I mentioned, you know, our goal with our Plan Toronto was to help build relationships with Indigenous peoples and communities and First Rights, treaty rights holders and First Nations. So, like I said, we're going to incorporate the feedback that we get from the AAAC when we go on June 13th. We're going to continue our engagement, as I mentioned, with treaty rights holders and caretakers and organizations across the city. And we hope to prepare a final report again in early 2023 on recommended changes to chapter one of the official plan that incorporate a refined version of what I presented to you, because it's not perfect at the moment. I don't think it ever will be perfect, but I think we just want to continue to refine and incorporate input and learn some more and reflect some more. And with that, I think it's an engagement moment.
Yeah, so we have another poll, so you can go back to your mentee, and we have one question for you here for this section. So again, the code is 9982-1574. And our question is, are you familiar with the city's reconciliation action plan that was recently adopted at City Council? So again, we have the answers yes, no, or I will look at it after the meeting. So we have a couple of people already. We're giving you homework today. So thank you. So we have a few people who have had a look at it and they are familiar with it. One person that's not, and a bunch that are going to look at it after the meeting. Go on to the next section here. And this is the official plan vision, the draft official plan vision statement and directions. And I'll hand it back over to Jeff to present.
Great, thanks, Kristen. This is our last kind of mini presentation before we kind of go into next steps. So similar to the Indigenous planning perspective, another component that we are engaging on, and we will prepare final reports for City Council on chapter one is the new directions and principles that I'm just going to speak about. So this the next slide is kind of our layered approach of the draft directions and principles for chapter one of the official plan. And I'll go through the ingredients of this graphic. So on the first slide, so as we plan for 2051, our draft vision statement for the city is that the official plan should seek to eliminate disparities experienced by Torontonians. The official plan should prioritize climate action and sustainability towards net zero. And the official plan should be the roadmap for Toronto to become the most inclusive city in the world. And I'll quickly take you through these one by one. So the first one, where, in the next slide, what does it mean to eliminate disparities? Well, for us, it means that we as a city need to acknowledge that the post-pandemic recovery must acknowledge that people have had different lived experience. And these different lived experience vary among those that have the privilege to work at home versus those that had to go to work because their jobs were essential. What this also means to us is that the systemic effects of our land use planning we should challenge these systemic effects and look to basically outcome-based directions that help meaningfully reduce disparity and build up what's known as social cohesion. It also means building complete communities that offer supportive opportunities for people of all ages, all abilities, who can conveniently access most of the necessities of daily life, including a mix of jobs, stores, services, a full range of housing, active transportation for those who do not have cars, and then the community services that we all need for our daily life. The next slide is about climate action. So we are prioritizing climate change. We know that climate change is one of the biggest challenges facing our planet, and so our land use decisions should work towards achieving sustainability towards the goal of net zero by 2040. And this also includes prioritizing Indigenous worldviews and relational views of land protection around resiliency. And on the next slide, we want Toronto to become the most inclusive city in the world. We know that development will continue to happen across the city of Toronto. The province has forecasted us to grow by 700,000 people and 450,000 jobs. The city doesn't have control over the levels of immigration that come into Canada. But what we do know year over year, the city of Toronto takes in a good percentage of those newcomers into the city. So trying to become the most inclusive city in the world is an important piece to our planning puzzle. And so as we grow, we will make sure that we are welcoming to newcomers. So the next slide. So how do we get there? So those were our vision statements. So the three principles in chapter one, these are draft, that help us get to that vision is about successful and inclusive city building. So successful city building requires, we think, three main ingredients: access, equity, and inclusion. So access is about improving access to many facets to daily life, access to jobs, access to transit, access to affordable housing, universal accessibility for those living with physical disabilities. You know, we heard during some of our engagement meetings that that big snowfall we had in February really limited people with mobility issues in terms of getting to a grocery store, for example, because there's just a lot of snow. In terms of equity, when we talk about applying an equity lens, what that means is for us to be identifying and removing the barriers for the city's most marginalized and vulnerable communities, and for achieving growth, because we know we are going to grow, but achieving that growth that is positive and inclusive. And lastly, in terms of inclusion, it's going back to make sure that we're creating a safe and inclusive city for today, for today's Torontonians, for those of us living in Toronto, and for those yet to arrive. And so these three principles help us get to experiencing that the draft vision that we've created. Okay, and I think that wraps it for me. Back to you, Kristen.
Okay, great. So we do have a couple last polling questions for you, and this is to get your feedback on the vision and the draft directions and principles that were just presented by Jeff. So if you open up your Menti, there will be two more questions and it's about how supportive are you of the official plan vision that Jeff just presented. And you'll see kind of the three items there that eliminate disparities that Jeff walked us through, prioritize climate action, and the most inclusive city. So for all of those, I guess we want you to rank your agreement with them. So I'll give you a moment now to enter your answers and responses. And if you do have concerns or any responses to those, please add them in the chat as well, because we'd like to hear from you about what could be added or your thoughts on these things. So we have about for the same for all of them, or now it just shifted. So it's about 3-point-something for all of them. So in our scale, I think that's between somewhat agree and agree somewhere around there. Okay, maybe we'll go to the next question. So the next one is about the principles that Jeff presented. So there was three principles there: the access, equity, and inclusion. So again, looking for how much you support these principles for the new official plan. And this will be our last Mentimeter question for this evening, and we appreciate all of you playing along with us so we can hear back from you. Okay, so again, kind of in the between 3.6 and 3.8. And again, if you do disagree with these, I would love to hear why in the chat. So feel free to share. Or if you are supportive of some of these items and you want to add your comments as well, feel free to do so. Okay, thanks everyone for participating. I will ask Jeff to talk about some of the next steps that are going to be taking place on his end, and Also maybe just provide some reflections from this evening on what you heard and what the conversation was about this evening.
Sure. Thanks, Kristen. So immediate next step. So next week, our environment team is bringing forward final report with final official plan updates on environment and climate change that we've been was on a different stream of consultation. I think we had meetings last month, or I think it was last month. So the final report is public right now for environment and climate change. If you're interested in that, we can also put that link to that staff report in the chat. And as I mentioned, or as members of my team mentioned today, that on July 5th, Planning and Housing Committee will be bringing a couple final reports on some of the major transit station areas and protected major transit station areas. We will bring final reports on our employment policies and some final assessments on some conversions. And I stress the word some, we're not going to be able to get to them all. And then over the course of after July, we'll be doing continued engagement, and in early 2023, we will complete the MCR with the final phases of the remaining major transit station areas, the remaining employment area conversions, and then the Chapter 1 vision statement and principles that I presented earlier tonight. So yeah, that's there's a lot on our plate, but we're going to continue through this. And I guess, sorry, go ahead, Kristen.
Oh, no, I was going to go to the next slide, but I think you're about to provide some reflections.
Yeah, you know, it's coming up to 8, and I think that although this is a virtual meeting, but I'm glad that those who were able to participate in the chat were able to engage with members of the city team who are all here. So thank you to the city team for keeping busy. This evening, and you know, quickly looking through the chat, it's a very engaged community that we have, and it's good to see, it's good to hear. You know, we, I believe, try to answer as many questions as we possibly could. There may be some that we haven't yet answered, and so my apologies for that. Feel free to email members of the team. I see Angela just put her email address. If not, if you don't have an email address, we have opreview@toronto.ca. A number of members of my team monitor that email address, and one of us will get back to you. So thank you for joining us tonight. I hope you feel engaged in this process. And again, thank you to the staff team, and thank you to Kristen and your team for helping us through a very big agenda that we've gone through. So okay. Over to you.
Thanks, Jeff. So we'll go to the next slide, and I'll just talk about some of the other upcoming engagement activities that we have coming up. So tonight, again, was the first in a series of meetings. Tomorrow night, same time, we have the Scarborough Town Hall. Then next week, we have North York and Toronto East York on the Monday and then the Wednesday. Then we have our statutory public open house, which is also a virtual meeting. We have that on June 7th, and that's from 1 till 3 p.m. So in the afternoon, to offer people a bit of a different time slot for those who may not be able to attend in the evenings. And then, as has been mentioned throughout this meeting, there's a couple other meetings coming up that are to dive into specific policy areas. And that's employment lands and the future of work. So that's on June 21st. For neighborhoods and complete communities, that's on June 22nd. And then housing and intensification on June 23rd. And I know a lot of you were talking in the chat about some of these areas, so I hope that you're able to attend those evenings where we dive a bit deeper into these subjects. I also wanted to again plug that we do have a new story map live on the Our Plan website, and that's to share some of this information that you have seen presented tonight. So if you share that with your friends, colleagues, neighbors, that would be fantastic. And I know it has been already put into the chat, but if you could add that again into the chat, our story map, so people can link to it and check it out after the meeting. So next slide. So yeah, as Jeff said, a big thank you to everyone who participated tonight, whether you just observed or you were engaged in the chat, we really appreciate you being here tonight and sharing your thoughts and ideas and perspectives. We heard a lot around the MTSA areas and the boundaries and some of the density targets. We heard a lot about overdevelopment and some concerns there, as well as protecting some key employment areas in the city. And also some mention of different ways to move forward with engagement and whether that means in-person meetings in the future. So again, a big thank you to everyone. I hope that you'll join us for other meetings in the future. And we'll end a couple minutes early tonight and enjoy the rest of your evening and take care. So we'll see you soon. Thank you.